time to switch gears from politics and hit the open road, whether you drive on the right or the left. So buckle up, check your mirrors, and hit the gas. It's time for Burning Rubber with Ligotti and the Car Doctor.
Hey, Doctor, Doctor, oh, the doctor of mine. How are you, pal?
I got nothing to do with your daughter's transmission.
Well, I don't understand. As I told you, I probably should have just bought three new cars when we started this segment because, again, I probably could have bought three new cars at what I've spent. Something about the, and I saw the transmission, John, by the way, yesterday. They got it back. It's totally new. And something about a computer that costs a ton of money, a computer that goes on this transmission because it's four-wheel drive or something. And then, but something about a valve. Some valve needs to be replaced now, too, because it's causing a leak. Do you know what this valve is?
No. I don't. Yeah, it's the. Well, she's got what, a Camry? What does she have?
No, she's got a. What do you call that little SUV?
The Jeep. The Jeep something?
No, the Nissan XTerra.
XTerra.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I don't know. Something about a valve or maybe something that, I don't know. I just have no idea. I trust my mechanic very much. He said to me, look, I was trying to save you, you know, $600 to $800 on this thing so that if we didn't have to replace this one part, you know, it was going to be a surprise. You didn't owe me that much money, but of course it didn't work out for you. As soon as we hooked everything up, that part went, and I don't know. So all I know is that hopefully Monday and Tuesday, my next segment, I could tell you how wonderful the car is driving, but then something will be wrong with my car, trust me.
Well, you know, your previous segment with the, you know, with the financial person, you know, maybe her, you know, maybe you, me, and her need to sit down together.
Yeah, because I could, listen, I could use a brand new Escalade, and I know that you liked the Rolls you were driving.
The Rolls was good.
Yeah, I mean, again, yeah. I don't mind taking out a loan. You know, we'll just, I don't know. Do you know how to sign the Salem comptroller's name? I mean, I could look at my check next time I get one, but
yeah. Okay. Anyway. When you figure it out, let me know.
Yeah, roger that. Hey, just to let you, to talk to you about this, have you ever heard, I'm sure you heard of Smoky and the Bandit, right?
Of course.
Of course. And of course, I'm sure that you saw them all being the car buff that you are, right?
I may have seen one or two. Yeah,
one or two, right? Yeah. Burt Reynolds, as we all know, passed on last year, okay? Mm-hmm. But he had that iconic 79 Trans Am. Now, I'm going to tell you, I grew up during that era, and I'm sorry, a Trans Am, a Camaro, I mean, you were the hottest you-know-what in the neighborhood if you had one of those T-top Trans Ams. Why don't you talk about the Trans Am first, and I'll tell you what the actual Bandit Trans Am sold for.
Well, the Smoky and the Bandit, or the, you know, that car, the Trans Am, it was a lot of, it was honestly a lot of show and no go. It had that big screaming chicken on the hood.
Yeah.
It was really an eagle, but everybody called it the big screaming chicken. It, you know, that was not the best year for any GM cars. They were kind of hampered by emissions controls, but it did look pretty cool, and it was kind of an interesting car. I think the most of them were 77, 78, something like that, maybe. But it's one of those cars that, yeah, they go, you know, they should go for, you know, $40,000 or $50,000. What's the Burt Reynolds Smokey and the Bandit car going for?
It went for $317,500. Now, I would imagine that's because Burt Reynolds' tush touched the leather seat, I would imagine. I don't think it has any extra stuff in it.
Well, it sounds like, and maybe it's because, unfortunately, Burt passed on, but I'm pretty sure at some point Burt was broke.
Yeah, maybe that was to pay off some of his estate.
Yeah, yeah.
You know,
he wasn't doing there. You know, he had the Burt Reynolds Theater that closed up and went bankrupt. And, you know, I don't think his end years, I think he spent a lot of money. Maybe it was with the, divorce from the blonde on WKRP.
Lonnie Anderson. Yeah.
Yeah.
And not a lot of people know this because he was, you know, supposedly a sex symbol and all those movies. He started as an extra on Gunsmoke. Did you know that?
Well, I seem to remember him on Gunsmoke.
Oh, all right.
Actually,
yeah.
So
all right,
I don't remember him as an extra, but I seem to remember him occasionally.
Well, I know that he started as an extra, then got a part, and then he started as a Western guy. Of course, everybody in the 50s back then. And I have a friend of mine, John. It's interesting, these movie cars. I actually have a friend of mine. You know the blue LTD 1990 and 91 that was in the Men in Black thing? That had the special shifter and don't press the red button and all that stuff.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
I have a friend that actually bought it from the studio. There were actually five of them. And it comes with a letter of authenticity from the actual studio. And it comes signed also by the actors. So Tommy Lee Jones signed this one and Will Smith. So, again, they are big, I guess, if you're a car buff. I don't know. I know you like cars, but the Trans Am, what would you say the best car, the best Trans Am car was? What year, you think?
I think when you look at the Pontiac Trans Am and you look at the Camaros, for me, it was always the late 60s, early 70s, 70 and a half that had the better engine in it. The Camaro, especially the 69 Camaro Z28 with the 302 engine, which was a modified small block, that was a pretty hot car in its day. And those were cars that were, I looked at, I couldn't never afford it, and I know I can't afford it now today. So
right. So I mean,
I still want to go find the tractor trailer full of cores somewhere. Wasn't that the whole premise of that movie with the Bandit? Wasn't it?
This is true. Yeah, right. Yeah. Right. And it's what was his name? Buford T. Justice. That was Jackie Gleason. Yeah. But anyway, so the other thing, story that I had for you is that this woman actually took a Tesla Model 3, okay, and she turned it into a pickup truck. Do you see anything happening from Tesla like this? And I'm seeing more and more of these Teslas, John, out on the streets of Boston, by the way.
Yeah, I was just—I just gave a talk at the country club in Framingham to a bunch of
excuse me.
Yeah, I know. They were all attorney general's office volunteers and stuff. So I wasn't playing golf, but in the parking lot there was a Tesla, there was also an Aston Martin and a Bentley, but the woman who cut the roof and the trunk off the Model 3 Tesla and turned it into a pickup truck, I stumbled across that on YouTube the other day. Mm-hmm. She did a nice job with that.
Yeah.
And she's she builds those robots that fight each other kind of thing, that kind of stuff. But she did
rock 'em,
really
sock 'em.
She did a really nice job with this. And you know, Elon Musk says he's going to build a pickup truck. It's going to be, you know, it's going to be better than the Ram 1500. It's going to be cheaper. You know, time will tell. But there are a lot of people trying to modify Teslas. The problem is they don't let you do. You can't buy a lug nut for a Tesla unless you own one. So they're kind of funny about all their parts. So you have to go out. You have to be a renegade. You have to go buy one and do this crazy stuff to it.
There you go. Now, did you ever like the Hummers, John? I love them. I really do. I love the Hummers only because, you know, I live in the suburbs, and 7 months out of the year, there's a chance that we're going to have crappy weather, but it says now General Motors, of course, they put these things over 10 years ago on ice because they were just horrible in gas. They would get 9 gas stations to a mile. Mm-hmm. And now they're saying with all this electric stuff that they might revisit the HX Hummer, but it's going to be electric. What do you say about that?
There was the Hummer H1, which was the military one.
That's
That's the big one. That's the one that's 8.5 feet wide. That one's a little bit tricky to drive. The H2 was the one that was built on a Chevy Suburban platform, so similar to your Escalade. And then the H3 was built on a smaller pickup truck. The H2 certainly has enough space under it to put a bunch of batteries in it. So if you know, Mary Barra, the president of GM, is really focused on kind of on trying to come out with some electrification plan that they want to electrify a bunch of cars. That would be one. And, you know, it's not a Chevy Bolt. It's not a little tiny car that it's right. going to be this great big, you know, car. And let's face it, when I don't care what's going on out there in the economy right now, but people are still going and they're buying SUVs, they're buying pickup trucks, they're buying big vehicles, and maybe GM has a right idea. Let's build a big electric truck and see if people come and buy it.
I agree with you, and it's the reason is because I think, you know, you still got the soccer moms and you got the kids with the hockey equipment, but there's no such thing as a beach wagon anymore. And that used to be, when I was a kid, the big beach wagon with the fake wood on the side and, of course, the seat that faced backwards. I mean, that would be child cruelty right now, you know, to have that window down and you sitting in the back. Did you have one of those, John? Or
my father was a salesman for a plumbing company, oh. and his company car was a station wagon. So that's all I grew up with from his Rambler wagon right up until his Kingswood estate. So yeah, there was a lot of rear facing seats and carbon monoxide coming in cars, and you know, that was always the rear facing yeah. seat was always the car seat too. Something about facing that other way for a long time just isn't all that healthy.
All I could tell you is that I enjoyed breathing in all those carnages. And it didn't affect me at all. I'm sorry, John. It's just a little tick I had. Anyway, John Paul, he's the car doctor. Why don't you tell everybody what's going to happen on your show this week and how to get a hold of you?
Well, the easiest way is to just drop me an email. It's jpaul@aaanortheast.com. Or you can go to aaa.com/cardoctor. You can find me there. This week, I believe I'm having old buddy Junior D'Amato. Junior D'Amato owns Junior's Automotive in Hyde Park and Middleborough. He's getting ready to close down the Hyde Park facility. So it's going to be kind of a sad day for him. He's been there for 50 years.
Wow.
So he's moving that shop. He added onto his shop in Middleborough. And he's a car guy. Like, he's got a dozen cars and fast boats and all kinds of fun stuff. So he's always a good guy to talk to.
There he is. Is it 10 o'clock, right?
Early. It's before you get up. It's 8:30 in the morning. 8:30.
What is kind of? I can't get up that early. All right. The car doctor. We love him, John Paul. We'll see you, buddy.
Talk to you next week, Joe.